What you talking about? Fly high up in the sky. Get with the feeling if you want to feel that. Fly high up in the sky. On the wheel, y'all. On the wheel, y'all. Don't stop.
ESPN America isn't just your source for North American sports in Europe and the Middle East.
It's a community that brings American sports fans together.
We've taken fandom to the next level by teaming up with Twitter and Facebook.
So you can debate the hottest sports topics with other passionate fans.
And follow some of your favorite ESPN American personalities.
What are you waiting for? Get online and join our community.
Check out ESPN America's great apps on Facebook.
And follow us on Twitter.
These men wrote their own legends on the white lines of football's biggest stage.
Elway now, his helmet is off, both arms extended in the air.
Others knew destiny demanded they wear the ring.
Montana rolls to his right, throws to French, touchdown 49ers!
And some rose to a single occasion and into history. In each case, their value was recognized by the world. And for living so large, in moments that test the mettle of men, a place in football's folklore is reserved for them.
Eli Manning is in quite a fraternity, that of the Super Bowl winning quarterbacks, of course. Yet until this season, he's been looked upon as Peyton's younger brother, in his shadow, despite being the one playing in the Big Apple. But after his performance all year for the Giants and more road wins in the postseason, of course, include taking a pounding but never flinching in the heroic NFC Championship game performance at San Francisco. This truth is evident today in 12 hours. If the Giants win, he'll have won one more Super Bowl than his famous record-setting brother. And some of Eli's best plays have come while he's seemingly, pardon me, rumbling, bumbling, and stumbling until the play is over. And once again, he's escaped danger. Here's Rachel Nichols.
Elusive, tending to evade grasp or pursuit, otherwise defined as Eli Manning.
Manning's under pressure. He's going to step up and throw one left, caught at the 22-yard line.
Eli, mobile enough to throw on the run there.
It's not planned. It's not even particularly pretty. But when Manning shifts, shuffles, and sidesteps his way around the pocket, good things usually happen for the New York Giants.
You don't think that he has those quick, subtle feet in the pocket, but he does. He's able to create some space for him to throw the football.
I'm sure in the scouting report coming out of college, elusive wasn't one of the words that was being used. But, you know, all jokes aside, that, you know, a guy like Eli is tough to sack.
Sometimes you don't have an option. Sometimes, hey, the rush is coming to your right. You want to work to your right, but you got to move left, and you hope someone, you know, comes into your vision.
Can't keep running away. Can't keep running away.
Manning's moxie in the pocket is responsible for the biggest play of his career.
When I saw the second hand come over the shoulder, I'm like, oh, we can't afford a sack right now at this time. And all of a sudden, he shot out about 5 yards.
He shook out of it, was able to keep his eyes still downfield and hit David Tyree, and we all know where that led us and what it got us.
This season, Manning has perfected that elusiveness. There was the crucial fourth quarter, third and seven throw to Victor Cruz that helped push the Giants past the Cowboys and into the postseason.
He's under pressure. He rolls left, throws it deep down the middle of the field for Cruz, who makes the catch in between two defenders.
That is the spark they needed.
And in the NFC Championship game, a heart-stopping twist past the lunging arms of the San Francisco pass rush to get the ball to Ahmad Bradshaw.
Standing in pump fake, spinning away, pressure, dumps it up, Bradshaw open in the flat. Man, was that some play. Manning did a great job to spin to his left as he was about to get crushed by Alden Smith.
Did this guy have like eight
sets of eyes like across his head, because he seems like he can feel guys that are getting close to him, and he just knows exactly when to get rid of the ball.
I've gotten better over the years, better understanding of the offense, more understanding of protection, understanding that, you know, some of these hits don't hurt as badly as they look sometimes. I can hang in there and make the throw.
But Manning doesn't always stay in the pocket. Sometimes he's forced to scramble. At least that's what he calls it.
He's going to tuck it down and run and in for the touchdown. Eli Manning, not known for his nimble feet, runs it in.
We say somebody, when they run really beautifully, they run like a gazelle. What would you say that Eli runs like?
An ugly duckling. He runs like a wounded gazelle.
It's hard to characterize it. It's kind of a little fish out of water at some point.
He runs like an elephant, but they're faster than you think.
How do you think you look when you're doing it?
Probably not real good. In my opinion, sometimes it doesn't matter how you look, it's how effective it is.
All right, Rachel, thank you very much. I mean, maybe not in the Lou Brock, Ricky Henderson sliding mode, but I didn't think that was really a prerequisite to play quarterback, Super Bowl winning quarterback. Speaking of two guys that have done that. Steve, Trent, Eli, I don't want to call it an evolution because he's obviously been a very good player and in clutch before. But this year there's something different. What do you see and what do you make of it?
Well, I think, Boomer, there's something different. And I think that it came out of the beginning of the season. You know, I always worried that Eli was missing that requisite killer instinct. I don't know how to put it. His brother Peyton, very kind fellow, very nice, but he's got that assassin in him. And all great quarterbacks have that. I thought he was missing that this year. I think it's still Eli. He hasn't changed dramatically, but there's subtle changes. At the beginning of the year, I had heard that he said on the radio, which is no big deal, "Are you an elite quarterback?" "Yes, I am." And then he started to play like, well, if I said it, I better make it true.
I got to be it.
It became self-fulfilling. And I noticed that he just played with more confidence. Eli Manning made the speech to the team before they came out here to the game. He's the kind of guy that now makes the speech. He stands up and takes the responsibility. I think those are things that were missing before that he's grown into. And I saw Archie last night, and I said, he's not Peyton. He is Eli. In his own Eli way, he's figured out a way to be great.
Yeah, and he really has been great. And the thing that jumps out to me, guys, is mastery of his offense. I mean, you look at the greatest quarterbacks in this league, and Justin Tuck says, they have eyes everywhere. They know where everybody is all the time. A lot of quarterbacks know every progression on the sheet of paper, but they go out on the football field and they get locked into one or two. This guy, think of all the signature plays he's made this year. It hasn't been five-step foot in the ground to number one or number two. It's backside, his fourth option, scrambling around, creating space for himself. He's been so unbelievable this season at getting to alternate receivers in huge clutch moments.
The last touchdown in Atlanta in the playoff game, left, right, yeah. Oh, down. He saw Mario kind of break through the end and throws the dime at the back of the end zone. I said, I watched it. I said, that is big time.
Yes.
I remember when you used to sit over here. Welcome back.
Salad days.
He's back.
Salad. Cobb salad, maybe.
Lone Ranger and Tonto. What happened to it?
What happened to us? So Tommy and Teddy, I mean, let's go this way. A long time they'll see Teddy. Do the Patriots have an answer on defense to what Eli is providing?
I think they have some of the answers. When you look at the pass rush, Rob Ninkovich, Mark Anderson on the outside have been two guys who have brought good pressure. 16 and a half sacks between them. But I think the problems come when you start talking about coverage of their skill guys. And we've talked about it all week, and now I think it's time to answer the question. Where is Julian Edelman going to be when we run spread, we get 3 and 4 wide? Now, in the championship game, he was on Anquan Boldin, and that was made to look pretty easy coming down the field at the end of the game. You know, and you look at the Giants, and the playmakers that they have in Akeem Nix, Mario Williams, Victor Cruz, I mean, it's just an issue. And it's one that's going to be answered, I think, fairly early in the game.
Yeah, with Mario Manningham, Victor Cruz, you know, Nix, those guys on the outside. The Patriots' DBs are outmanned, all right? The wide receivers of the Giants outman the Patriot defensive back. So the only answer in my mind for the New England Patriots has got to be Vince Wilfork. He has got to be a force in the middle to get that pressure up the middle of the pocket. He broke out in the AFC Championship game. I hadn't seen Vince have a game like that where he was so disruptive and finishing the plays in terms of tackles for losses, getting to the quarterback, bringing him to the ground. That has to be done against Eli Manning because those DBs, you know, they've got their hands. They've got the work cut out for them.
Well, Vince picks up a ball and runs 50 yards like you did earlier in the season. Then
that would help, too.
Yes. I'll go back to you on this, Teddy, because I remember 10 years ago against the greatest show on turf, I mean, and a word from Coach Belichick and you guys, the defense, whatever we do, Marshall Faulk's not going to, and that's a big
right,
to say.
Right.
He's not going to beat us, and if they beat us doing everything else, that's the way it goes. If there is a giant that they could deal with, would it be Victor Cruz? Because he's at the slot. I mean, would that be the one they might
pound? That's the guy. That's the guy. It's Victor Cruz. I mean, Marshall Faulk was the guy for the Rams. It's Victor Cruz for this guy. Him in the slot would provide the most problems for the New England Patriots. So this is the guy they're going to try and take away. And what they believe on that defensive coaching staff is make them take away the high percentage throws, yes, okay?
Right.
In between the numbers, in the middle of the field. And that just so happens to be where their most dangerous weapon is, Victor Cruz. You take him away. You got to put Edelman there because you don't want to put him on the outside.
Anywhere outside.
He's outmatched there. You can give him help in between those numbers, but if Eli Manning is going to beat you throwing deep and outside the numbers, the back shoulder fades, the comebacks, then you put up your hands and say, you got us, kid, but don't give them the easy way out.
And boom, one of the ways the Patriots have done this well lately is by disguising coverages. And you can get a quarterback to hold the ball a little bit longer if you give him a little brain candy, make him think. And you start doing that now, Will Fork, Nikovic, those guys can start getting there a little bit better. So look for the Patriots to give a lot of defensive looks to disguise.
There's not a matchup that you like here, Giants and the Patriots defense. The only matchup I like is Bill Belichick in his room the last 2 weeks. You give him 2 weeks, he'll figure something out. The thing I will say, the NFL is becoming more like the NBA. The regular season is not as important. Right? You get into the tournament and then you roll. And if you take just the Patriots' last 2 weeks, their defense,
pretty good.
As an isolation, that's what makes this a game and that matchup a little bit more effective. But boy, one-to-one matchups from the Patriot defense on the Giants offense, okay. I don't like any of them.
Well, I guess that's one of the things we're saying. So we bring in Bill Parcells here, who certainly, Bill, good morning and happy Super Bowl to you. You certainly have insights of both directions and all sorts of feelings. This Patriot defense that the fellas have described, certainly better the last couple of weeks. During the regular season, not so good. Do they have at least a partial answer with the personnel that they have in your eyes?
Well, I think they do, Chris, if they can do one thing. I agree with what the fellow said. I don't like the passing matchups on either side. I think both teams are very, very threatening to the other team's defense that way. But I think Eli Manning's best friend today could be the balance with Ahmad Bradshaw. I think if it's just a straight-out passing contest, I think the Patriots have the edge there. But I think if Eli can relax a little bit, get it to Bradshaw, create a little balance in the running game, keep the constant pressure off him, I think the Giants have a better chance. If it's just a shootout passing game, my money's going with the Patriots.
Well, if it is a shootout passing game, right or wrong, Coach, look, Victor Cruz, you talk about a breakout season, and Bradshaw, by the way, missed a couple practices, but that's the way they do it. He often doesn't practice except for once all week long, and then it's excellent. But Victor Cruz, and we saw him against San Francisco in the slot. I mean, he's been a revelation. And then there's Wes Welker in the slot. How about this? 5 years as a Patriot, regular and postseason, 600 catches. Hello? 600. Everybody agreed with me that the men in the slot hold big keys to this game.
In the three wides, it gives us versatility. It gives us a guy that can attack the single matchup coverage, the double coverage, getting into the middle of the field if he has to, breaking to the outside, giving it what we call the sail ideas. All of those things are made possible by the quickness and the ability of that guy in the slot.
A lot of times the route isn't real precise. It's kind of, hey, you know, find the zone, sit up, and I'll throw it to you. And you just need a guy who's comfortable and has a good feel for that.
I think a lot of what we do is try to get the ball to, you know, those inside combinations. And, you know, when you're an inside receiver, you can really get to anywhere on the field. If you play outside the numbers, there's only a few routes you can really run.
That receiver has more options. He's in the middle of the field. He can go inside, outside, and deep, and the guys on the outside just have a little bit less space to work in. So if you have good players in there, then there's a lot of different ways you can use them and try to get them the ball.
Well, we got good players. When we return, our receivers, Chris Key, and somebody named Jerry Rice. I don't really remember him, but we're going to meet him in a minute. Well, they dig a little deeper. We'll go to Demo Field next.
ESPN America, bringing you the best NHL action all season long. On Tuesday night, Atlantic Division rivals face off at Madison Square Garden. Lundqvist and the Rangers are flying high, but Kovalchuk and the Devils are ready to shut them down. Devils at Rangers, Tuesday at 0100 CET, live on ESPN America.
Browns.
There's no way anybody's driving the Broncos 98 yards against this team in this stadium.
You never know with Elway and company. They've got the great capability of striking quickly.
When we started turning it loose, it was almost things they hadn't seen the whole game, and so it was almost a new look for the defense.
Instead of punching, they were counter-punching. They were always trying to figure out, boy, what do we do next? It was like,
get him.
42 seconds to go. Third down and a yard. The look, the throw, touchdown! 98 and a half yard drive.
We're getting excited about what's going on. They were getting very depressed about what's going on.
The Denver Broncos have come from behind to win it in overtime.
It was like a slow death. It was
a sense of respect about what we had done.
That game was kind of my coming out party because I think there was a lot of doubt before that whether I'd ever be a good quarterback or not.
They took it. The best team on that.
ESPN America, the finest athletes in the game take center stage. The NCAA college hoop season rolls on with live coverage from campuses across the nation. Modern-day gladiators step into the ring every Friday on Friday Night Fights. And hockey's best go head-to-head as the superstars of the NHL face off. The brightest stars, the biggest games, all this month live on ESPN America.
We're going to talk about Super Bowl wide receivers. It's going to start right here with Hall of Famer and three-time Super Bowl champion Jerry Rice. He's got more points, more touchdowns, more yards, and more receptions than any other player in Super Bowl history. Rice was named the MVP of Super Bowl 23 after catching 11 passes for 215 yards and a touchdown. So we're not going to talk Super Bowl receivers without you, so welcome. Now, the key thing with the Giants is their top three guys, all young, first time in the big game. Take us back to your first time. What was it like?
Okay, Susan, we're going to get to that, but I'm a little disturbed about the Pro Football Hall of Fame and their decision yesterday. You know, I felt like with the receivers, Andre Reed, Chris Carter, Tim Brown, what are the qualifications that you need to get into the Pro Football Hall of Fame? We got Chris Carter over 1,000 yards. We had Tim Brown over 1,000 yards. And so for not any of those guys to get in, I was very disturbed about that. Now, these guys that are facing this game tomorrow, Hakeem Nicks, Victor Cruz, Manahan, all those guys, you know, those guys are going to go out there. They're going to make plays. They're ready for the opportunity to go out to prove to everyone.
What do you remember from that first time?
Well, what I remember is that I could not I could not visualize everything that was going to happen in that game, but I just didn't want to mess it up. So I prepared the right way. I think the night before, I put myself in situations where I would make opportunities to make big plays to help my team to win, and I was able to go out there and have a great performance.
But you didn't get much sleep.
Not at all.
That was the key. Now, let's get to the Giants and what the Patriots need to do against this wide receiving core, because it's interesting to note that for all of Eli Manning's big throws, The throws themselves weren't all that big. The throws are a little bit shorter, and it's the receivers turning those throws into big yards. What do the Patriots need to do to stop that?
Absolutely, Suze. People think that if you're going to make big plays in the passing game, that the ball has to travel far in the air. But what the Patriots have to do, and I'm going to call it the Jerry Rice effect, the best in the National Football League ever, getting the ball and trying to get him down within 5 yards. Jerry Rice was the best in the league as far as making someone miss, getting up to full acceleration within 5 yards, and taking it to the house and making big plays. The Patriots, they have to be very, very good tacklers, because Hakeem Nicks, Manningham, and Victor Cruz, all of them, if you don't get them on the ground, it'd be a lot of salsa going on in the Super Bowl.
Well, what Victor Cruz will do to the New England Patriots is he'll make them declare what they want to do in the secondary. Okay, you have to make a decision on which guy's going to guard which. You got Nicks, you got Manningham, you even have the tight end. So Victor Cruz is just left out there. Now you have to decide which one of your secondary guys you're going to put on him and match him up. And it could be a long Jerry Rice type day if something goes wrong.
Yeah, Patriots cornerback Devin McCourty made the point. What makes Cruz so dangerous is you think of slot receivers and you think of smaller guys, quicker. They're trying to avoid contact. Mm-hmm. He's big and physical. He's looking for the contact, but he still is shifty enough to make those moves. And when you talk about shifty, then that's Wes Welker, who's basically set the standard for slot receivers for the last 5 seasons. This was his finest season. What do the Giants do about him?
I think with Wes Welker, he's that security blanket for Tom Brady. And this guy caught over 122 balls, and he knows how to get open. And it's going to be a big test for Antrell Rowe to try to cover this guy.
Here's how you neutralize Wes Welker. You give him basically a two-way go. You double-team him inside and outside. When he comes down, he breaks left, he breaks right. You got him secured. You don't have to worry about him going up the rail if you do that. If you allow somebody to match him up one-on-one and he runs the shallow crosses, that's when you're going to get in trouble because you'll be in a trail technique suit.
And that's it. And Jerry mentioned Antrell Rowe. Welker had a pretty big game against him. The tight ends had pretty big games in week 9 as well. Gronkowski's the big story. How would you stop him?
I don't know if you're going to stop him. If he's healthy, you're not going to stop. Gronkowski is a guy, because of his size, he's open when he's not open. You understand what I mean? If the quarterback throws the ball in the right spot, he can catch it. Put it up there high, he can catch the football. That's all there is to it. This guy is a special football player. Maybe these guys come along once every decade. Hey, look at this. I mean, I don't know. Most tight ends that I've ever seen, the ball's over their head. This guy makes a big play, and that's what he is. Even the fact that his ankle's hurt, I think he's going to be able to go down the field, uncover, find a hole, they'll get the ball to him.
Suze, also, he gives them that big target in the outside lane. Their wide receivers are small, and they don't throw the ball outside the numbers a lot. But when you got Gronk out there, it gives them that Randy Moss deep threat from an unconventional way.
Big thing is where he lines up, too. He lines up on the inside.
You don't want to line this guy up on the inside. You want to line him up on the outside where he's going to get opportunities.
Absolutely.
And also with that ankle being hurt.
Yeah.
6'7", but he's really 6'10" when his arms goes up.
Yeah, Deion Grant said the attitude for the Giants on Gronkowski is ABG. Anybody can get it. They're going after him. And
yes.
Chris, I think you may have mentioned Yak's start right here.
Yeah. Infinity.
He invented it, yeah. And this is going to be a fun matchup in terms of yards after the catch and yards after contact. 4 of the top 5 wide receivers and tight ends in terms of yards after the catch will be on the field today. Welker led all players with more than 700 yards after the catch during the regular season. The only other wideout or tight end with more than 600 yards were Rob Gronkowski and Victor Cruz. Now, more in regard to Cruz, what makes this even more remarkable is nobody saw this coming, not even the Giants.
That's right, Susie. In fact, the Giants would love to say they knew Victor Cruz would have a breakout season, but in talking with general manager Jerry Reese this week, he said Cruz's status with the team was almost diminished with a worrisome week 1 performance in which he had just 1 catch against the Redskins. And Reese said as soon as Cruz dropped a simple 3rd-and-8 pass from Eli Manning on the first series of the game, the thought was, maybe the game is just too big for this undrafted free agent. That's why they signed veteran Brandon Stokley. Either slot receiver, Stokley got hurt. They lit a fire under Cruz, and as you know, the rest is history, at least for this season.
And he may make some history today as well. Now, if you're not already revved up for the game, since this is Indy and the home of the Indy 500, why wouldn't we race our picks here, courtesy of Graham Rahal, youngest winner ever on the Indy circuit and son of Indy 500 winner Bobby Rahal? We need those picks before, too. We'll see how fast he is.
They may look like harmless dramas, but the motivation being provided by these ladies in this room could be the key to this year's Super Bowl. The story's coming later on Countdown.
Belichick and Keyshawn, the sweatshirt meets the sweater.
To the Super Bowl, you face the Giants. Now what?
Trying to get everything right, trying to play our best game. We all have that same focus, coaches, players, everybody's just trying to do their very best.
Before he goes for his fourth Super Bowl title, Key sat down with Bill Belichick to talk about his legacy. Catch all the action on Friday Night Fights, starting at 0300 CET, live on ESPN America.
Don't get no better than this, 3-3. Been waiting for this one. Hey, watch him, Jules. Hey, him! Both! 59! Which was that?
Brady to throw, looking, fires, caught, inside the goal, 5-yard line and into the end zone.
Way to hold up, fellas. It's a fun way to start this game, huh?
Wait till we set. We're gonna fight, we're gonna lay down. Right, y'all. Hey, take it to another level, all right?
Gotta work harder, gotta do more. We are not finished.
Gotta start competing, huh? Start playing with the fire, all of us.
It's gonna be a great comeback, guys. It's gonna be a great comeback.
Brady, quarterback sneak, right up the middle. Touchdown.
And Brady has been lights out.
That was a tough one.
Nice going, a lot man. Tougher. That was awesome.
Welcome back to Indy, where it's been a party all week long, especially at the Bud Light Hotel. Last night, artist Pitbull took the stage. Well, these guys were Pitbulls on the field, and our congratulations to the Hall of Fame class of 2012. Curtis, my favorite, Martin, along with Barry Sanders, the only two to have their first 10 seasons all 1,000-yard seasons. Patriots, Jets, 14,000 yards, retired, ranked fourth in rushing. Willie Rowe, such a standout at left tackle for mostly the Saints, later the Chiefs, all-decade team in the 90s. And Chris Dolman, 232 games, primarily for the Minnesota Vikings, 8 Pro Bowls, over 150 sacks. And then, of course, Dermoti Dawson, a center. First of all, he succeeded Mike Webster, tough enough as it is with the Steelers. He was a pulling center. Who does that? 184 games, great player. Supreme Cortez Kennedy, Seattle Seahawks, 58 sacks from the inside, was defensive player of the year. Third overall pick back in 1990, 8-time Pro Bowler. And when you have 52 interceptions in the 50s, as Jack Butler did, for a team that was then one of the worst, the Steelers, you're in. He'll be 85 this year. We're so glad that he's going to have a chance to experience that with his family. We bring in Mort, we bring in Adam, And we haven't had a chance to you guys yet to say happy Super Bowl Sunday to you both. Mort, can I just say something? Let me take a close look.
Actually, Boom.
You look marvelous.
I knew I did look marvelous. Boom, just to go back to the Hall of Fame here, and Jerry Rice alluded to this. You know, one of the things in talking to some of the voters for the Hall of Fame going into this week was they wanted to break the logjam at wide receiver among our Chris Carter and Tim Brown and Andre Reed, and they failed to do that. In the class of 2013, supposed to be a very tough class. And, oh, by the way, in 2014, Marvin Harrison, the Colts receiver, becomes eligible. So this is something that Hall of Fame committee needs to break through, and I would say needs to break through next year for sure.
Well, Mort, earlier we heard Ed Werder say that Tyquan Underwood was unlikely to be active today, but he will be entitled to receive his full Super Bowl money. The CBA says that any player active for 8 games is entitled to a full Super Bowl share. Tyquan Underwood was active for 8 games, which means if the Patriots win today, he gets his $88,000. And if they lose, he gets his $44,000. And if they win, he does get a Super Bowl ring.
And Colts owner Jim Irsay's statement of unity Friday with quarterback Peyton Manning was another truce after Irsay made 2 or 3 public misleading statements, including his claim that no quarterback has come back from this type of neck injury. In fact, a 2010 case study of 99 players with this neck injury revealed that 72% successfully returned to the playing field, including quarterbacks Chris Winkie and Brad Johnson. Winkie and Manning have been in contact because their cases are similar, according to Winkie, who won a Heisman at Florida State 1 year after a neck injury that required a fusion and total nerve regeneration. Winkie's words to a frustrated Manning have been encouraging, and his story defines a timeline that suggests Manning will be playing somewhere in 2012, if not Indianapolis.
Mort, if and when Peyton Manning is released, the Washington Redskins will pursue him. Most thought that was a possibility. It is a reality, but the Redskins have now put all their eggs in the Peyton Manning basket. They've also done some video research on other free agent quarterbacks, such as Matt Flynn, the Packers quarterback, and Kyle Orton, the Chiefs quarterbacks. Flynn and Orton could be options, and they've even had informal discussions about possibly going up to the number 2 pick that the St. Louis Rams now hold. And Boomer, earlier on today, Roger Goodell was on the Mike and Mike program, said he's not happy with the play at the Pro Bowl, and he and DeMar Smith have floated the possibility of canceling it. TJ?
Coming up later on Countdown, we talk legacy. For Bill Belichick, it would be the greatest of all time. But for Tom Coughlin, what will it be if he wins his second Super Bowl?
You know what, TJ? There's a lot of talk about a certain receiver playing defensive back. I know a little something about that when I was around Bill Belichick. I sat down and talked to the coach. Kiki, it's a tradition like no other, coach. Super Bowl moments that made us say, come on, mate.
Hey, Chris, listen, I learned something from Coach Landry a long time ago, and it's something that Coach Belichick and Coach Coughlin need to know today.
More of that good stuff coming up on Countdown.
College basketball doubleheader live on ESPN America. First, the Big East has the Hoyas face up to the high-flying Orange Men. Then it's all about the bragging rights as Duke and North Carolina renew the rivalries. It all starts Wednesday at 0100 CET on ESPN America, the home court of college hoops.
The New York people just talk real fast. There's a lot of real fast talkers.
They have a new word every day. It's hard to keep up with that language.
Somebody always has a guy. I got a guy. They got a guy for something.
Crazy, man, the way people talk. I can't even do it, you know.
No, I have no. I'm just a Southern guy from Alabama with the ball in the door.
The best. I got the best pizza. I got the best guy. I got the best. Everything's the best.
The site of Super Bowl 16 was a cold and icy Silver Dome in Pontiac, Michigan, where the San Francisco 49ers took on the Cincinnati Bengals. Montana's controlled passing helped San Francisco build a solid lead and shut out Cincinnati in the first half. But the Bengals bounced back in the second half, narrowing the gap to 20-14. Quarterback Ken Anderson connected with Dan Ross for a 4-yard touchdown pass and later scored on a 5-yard touchdown run. But with Ray Wershing's record-tying 4 field goals, the 49ers maintained the lead and took home the Lombardi Trophy.
And I never got tired, so my dad started calling me AD for all day, and it stuck with me ever since.
I like that, AD, all day.
Yeah, so what's your nickname around here?
Me?
Yeah.
I don't really have a nickname. Pretty much just call me Scott.
All day, what's up?
Same.
Hey, Bedwetter.
Guys are always clowning, you know.
Bedwetter.
Told you that in confidence. Johnny? Go ahead and get this fax out. All right.
SportsCenter, weekdays at 0700 CET on ESPN America.
The Super Sunday edition of NFL Countdown continues. Pan Am Plaza just a short distance from Lucas Oil Stadium. 37 degrees outside. Going to be in the mid-40s. Great day for the fans, and a lot of those Giants fans wearing jerseys of the best Giants defensive players, guys who can put pressure on the quarterback, guys they'd like to see laying on number 12 in a Patriots uniform in about 7 hours or so here in Lucas Oil Stadium.
It's fun. When you get the opportunity to hit it, man, you want to take advantage of that.
The sack back at midfield.
Anytime you can get to the quarterback, especially a guy like Tom Brady, that his team really revolves around how he plays, it feels pretty good.
Brady steps up. He's going to be hit and sacked at midfield. Tom never had a chance to get rid of that football.
He's one of those quarterbacks that just seems like it's such an honor to get the opportunity to hit.
I'll hit anybody. So if it's Tom Brady you know, they can put anybody out there and I'll hit him.
When you come off the line, you get that rush and you get that brief, you know, half a second when you're right there and there's nobody between you and the quarterback. The only thing left is getting him to the ground, and he can release the ball, and that's what happens, you know, 9 times out of 10. But that one time when you get there, I mean, it's a great feeling.
And it's been a feeling they've experienced multiple times in the last couple of matchups as we go IBM Insight Center. Super Bowl 42, the Week 9 regular season matchup, the pressure of the Giants on Tom Brady, the multiple sacks, putting him under duress, and you see Brady, usually a high, very high completion percentage, comes down significantly with the pressure put on by the Giants pass rush. As we bring in Rachel Nichols from the Giants Hotel. Rachel, this is something that has been the topic all week and a focus for this team going into Super Sunday.
Yeah, Jason Pierre-Paul didn't pull any punches. He told me, quote, "We have the best front four in football, and we are going after Tom Brady." Now, the Giants don't think this is going to be easy. They expect to see max protection, slide protections, chips, and a lot of plays designed for Brady to just get the ball out early. But they say even if they don't get those hits and sacks in the first quarter, their game plan is not going to change. They are going after the quarterback.
Anybody can be rattled. You know what I mean? Tom Brady is a great quarterback. But at the end of the day, you know, he's just a quarterback. You know, it ain't like he's God. He can't be untouched.
He's a great quarterback, but he's still just a man. If you hit him enough, he's going to get flustered. The fact of the matter is, if you get to a quarterback enough, if you hit him hard enough legally, then it's going to make him less effective. And that's our job up front. So that's what we're going to do.
You just keep pounding away. It's kind of like, you know, you're pounding away at a rock. Soon it's going to break. We haven't gotten to Brady's breaking point yet, but hopefully Sunday we can.
Now, Matthias Kiwanuka tells me that in watching film, they have seen some tells, some habits that Brady has that tip off what he's about to do, and they hope that's a help, especially when the Patriots go no huddle, since they won't have time to switch out the defensive personnel. As for Rob Gronkowski, the Giants plan to jam him at the line with a big body. See just how much he can take on that hurt ankle. And remember, guys, having their strong front four means they don't have to blitz that much. They blitz an incredibly low 18% of the time, so most of the time they're dropping having seven back in coverage, that gives them a little bit more flexibility to deal with the unexpected. And you know, Mike, the Patriots are going to throw something unexpected at them.
Yeah, Rachel, great point. It gives you more people to put extra attention on Gronkowski or Welker or whomever you choose. Back with John and Jaws. And let's go back to week nine. And every time we talk about the Patriots playing the Giants, and especially when we talk about the Giants' pass rush pressure, there's variety and volume, a lot of different guys who can do it. Show us what you saw in the regular season meeting.
You're absolutely right, Mike. And that week nine matchup to me was very instructive. And people talk about their front four. Yeah, it's a great front four, but the Giants were very effective with their blitz packages as well in that week nine matchup. And I'm going to show you one of the blitzes that was very effective in that game. It's a well-designed blitz, and it comes on third and 10, a critical situation in the third quarter. The Patriots were in their two tight end formation, three wide receivers on the field. This is what they like to do. The Giants played cover zero, man-to-man across the board. Of course, no deep safety in the middle of the field. It was the only time they played cover zero outside the red zone the entire football game. Watch Chad Ochocinco. He ran vertically right by Aaron Ross, but the ball never gets there. Tom Brady was sacked and fumbled. Why? The Giants rushed six. They're coming after Brady. The Patriots keep Hernandez and Gronkowski in the game to block. That's advantage Giants even before the snap. Focus on Michael Boley, on O.C. Umanura. They were matched one-on-one, the result of that six-man rush. Umanura's rush against Matt Light allowed Boley to loop around the outside. Brady's got to pick up his tempo, get the ball out. That's what you have to do when the pressure comes. Step up, Tom, deliver the football. Did not happen here. Michael Boley comes around the corner and gets the strip sack fumble on Tom Brady. Of the 15 throws that Tom made while being blitzed in that week nine matchup, he was only 6 of 15 for 92 yards. I expect to see some blitz pressure from the Giants.
The key to this Giant front four is Jason Pierre-Paul, number 90. He's a once-in-a-lifetime athlete. He could win the NBA dunk championship. He'd probably rip the backboard down. But JPP, his stamina to the ball, his ability to deflect passes and kicks, he's the guy you got to keep an eye on.
And we've seen him in a couple of years have a huge impact already. And this is the first time he's been on the same team back-to-back years in the last 4 or 5 years. So as he learns more, he's more of a factor and certainly will be one of the priorities of the Patriots on this Super Bowl Sunday. And I'm going to bring in Merrill Hodge now because there's another portion of this conversation. Rachel and John Gruden just talked about the pass rush pressure with the front four. Jaws showed us when they blitz, how effective they were in the first game. So Merrill, take it from the offensive side and for the Patriots, how do they try to combat what the Giants do so well in getting after Tom Brady?
Well, Mike, when you look at this game and the matchups favor the other team, which they do in this case with the Giants with their defensive line, then it comes down to scheme. And we know Belichick has been terrific at utilizing scheme. And I'll go back to that week nine matchup as Josh showed all of those pressures out of their 3-4 look and how they can go about neutralizing the matchups that don't favor them with scheme, putting six offensive linemen or seven on the field. There was two plays in this game that I want to show you in particular. We're going to start with one that ends up not being a touchdown, but it does illustrate how you can neutralize matchups with scheme. If the Patriots put six offensive linemen on the field, which they have here, Solder on the outside playing the tight end position as a tackle, they do a great job of play action, and they get exactly what they need in this scenario, a clean pocket, base personnel on the field for the Giants, not all those defensive ends, and Tom Brady has an ability to take the shot down the field. As Tom Brady comes out, look at the route combination. Welker on a crossing route. Ochocinco on the post. The guy that Brady must read now is Kenny Phillips, the safety in the middle of the field. Now, Phillips, for the most part, does a pretty good job, but as he starts to settle on Welker, now is when Tom Brady must pull the trigger and throw it to Ochocinco. If he does really quick here, this is a touchdown for the Patriots. But as we go to another angle, you'll just watch Tom Brady. He's a half a second a hair late on this one as he finally gets back to check, and it's too late. It's an incomplete. But what I loved about this, it was there, a design that would have given them a touchdown. In the game, though, they did complete some. Six offensive linemen. A run action this time, which is going to allow Tom Brady the clean pocket. It neutralizes all of the matchups that they could have. clean pocket for Tom Brady. There's a subtle difference in this one. This time, the single safety that's a man-free concept. Aaron Ross on Welker. Welker does a great job of beating Ross. Phillips is the single high safety. With the run action, it holds the underneath coverage because of their man concepts, and they're able to complete this play to Wes Welker because Welker does a great job of sticking Aaron Ross to the inside, breaking to the outside where there's all of that field for Wes Welker and Tom Brady. They were able to complete this pass. They missed the Chad Ochocinco one, but as this game gets ready to play, that is why to me it is the most anticipated Super Bowl ever, because you have scheme versus matchup. Now, will Tom Brady be sharp? He was not sharp in that Week 9 game. I've never seen him have two clunkers in a row. I expect him to be very sharp today and use this kind of scheme to neutralize the matchups the Giants do have.
And, Merrill, you're not alone in that. Come back here at the stadium and they bring in John Gruden. And, John, one of the reasons you've been leaning towards the Patriots here in this game is that Tom Brady factor that Merrill just talked about and your study of the first meeting between these teams and what Brady didn't do.
Yeah, nobody's perfect. Everybody's going to have a bad outing. And Tom Brady wasn't as sharp as he normally is in the game earlier in Foxborough. Take a look at it yourself. You have a play action pass. It's a one-man route. He's late down the middle. One hitch, two hits, three hitches. Tom Brady knows better. It won't happen today. Trust me. He knows he did the wrong thing. At the end of the first half, blitz coming, wide open receiver corner of the end zone. That's a slam dunk for Tom Brady. He never misses these throws. Ain't gonna happen today, Jaws. And then in a two-minute drive, he misses Gronkowski down the seam. You can talk about pressure, pass rush pressure, all you want with Tom Brady. There's a lot of talk out there. This ain't Tom Brady's first rodeo, Jaws. He doesn't feel pressure. He applies it. I believe you'll see that today.
Eddie?
If there's pressure, yeah, like there was in those shots, there's pressure up the middle. That's the area that you've got to affect Tom Brady with. That spot, 5 yards behind Tom Brady in this game, will be the critical real estate in this game.
And you think it won't happen again. It's funny because you think about the AFC Championship game. What's the first thing Brady said on the stand as they were doing the trophy presentation? How bad he was. And if you have him bad against the Giants, self-admitted, bad in the last game, the AFC Championship game, you know it'll be the already hyper-focused, even more intensified with Tom Brady on this Super Bowl Sunday here in Lucas Oil Stadium, where the preparations continue. The last things are being put in place inside of 7 hours until kickoff.
Coming up.
I'm under contract with the Colts. I play for the Colts right now, and that's where I am right now.
He's been the headliner in his hometown Super Bowl. How the war of words between Manning and Irsay will affect the future of the franchise. Coming out as a team.
I just remember everybody just in a little commotion. And finally, I think I stood up and I said, hey, no, we want to go out as a team.
10 years later, we look at one of the moments that defined their dynasty. IBM Insight Center is presented by IBM. Let's build a smarter planet. Visit ibm.com/smarterplanet.
Davis into the end zone, walking, standing up.
Third rushing touchdown. That's a Super Bowl record for TD.
It's the ultimate team sport when everybody can come together, one common goal, different backgrounds, and to walk away with a trophy like that, that's just an amazing accomplishment.
I went up with two hands. Once I felt that contact, I'm not letting go.
February 3rd, 2008, Super Bowl 42. The Giants found themselves 12-point underdogs to the undefeated Patriots, who were seeking NFL history.
The Patriots put the heat on Eli, and we got a chance to play a little backyard football.
The Giants' David Tyree, a special teams player who had caught only 4 passes in the regular season, made the most improbable play in this most unlikely of upsets.
Now he fires downfield, and it is caught. How in the world did he do that?
It just worked out to be something that was far beyond our comprehension. There were so many emotions that were going through me. I had tears, I had overwhelming joy.
ESPN America isn't just your source for North American sports in Europe and the Middle East.
It's a community that brings American sports fans together.
Oh my, can you believe that? Yeah!
We've taken fandom to the next level on ESPNAmerica.com.
Where you'll find unique and exclusive content tailored for our viewers, including podcasts, blogs, photo galleries, and competitions.
Plus, you can watch game highlights.
Oh, the silence of the lamb.
You've been lamb slammed.
And read behind-the-scenes interviews with some of your favorite athletes.
If that's not enough, we're available on Twitter and Facebook.
So you can debate your favorite sports topics with other passionate fans.
And follow some of your favorite ESPN America personalities.
Let's go to work.
Magnifique.
There's no question about that.
What are you waiting for? Join our community. Check out ESPN America's great apps on Facebook and follow us on Twitter.
Get into the game on ESPNAmerica.com.
Welcome back to this special Super Bowl edition of Sunday NFL Countdown, presented by IBM.
Throughout the season, we brought you lots of stories that help put football in its proper perspective. A lesson linebacker, Chris Draft, knows all too well. And Draft certainly loved the game, pouring his heart into 12 seasons, 6 teams, 150 games, and 89 starts. But that journey is just a small part of his story, a story of true love and courage. Here's Jeremy Schapp.
For as long as he can remember, Chris Draft has cherished what most of us take for granted, that next breath.
I mean, just gasping. Pretty much there, looking for the air.
Fighting to breathe is a way of life for Draft, who played linebacker in the NFL for 12 seasons, despite debilitating asthma attacks that often sent him to the hospital.
I look at it as a blessing of sorts, though, is that it makes me have to wake up and really take that breath each day.
What would you do today if every breath mattered? What decisions would you make if tomorrow wasn't guaranteed? Chris Draft and Keisha Rutledge met in 2006 when he was playing for the Carolina Panthers. There was an immediate connection.
Chris described Keisha as a beautiful woman who, walks through a room, brings a ton of personality.
But life in the NFL for a journeyman linebacker isn't conducive to settling down. Draft bounced from Carolina to St. Louis, to Buffalo, to Washington, where his career ended in 2010. All the while, Keisha waited.
Was there ever a point which she said, what's the deal?
There was a couple of times. There definitely was.
But what would you tell her?
I said, we're getting closer. No, she didn't like to hear that, but we're getting closer.
Finally, in 2010, Chris and Keisha were able to be together all the time. But suddenly, Keisha, a fit 37-year-old, a former dancer with the Charlotte Hornets Honeybees, started having trouble breathing. Despite the fact that she'd never smoked, Keisha was diagnosed with stage 4 lung cancer. The average life expectancy in such cases is 8 months.
You save one day at a time. But really, go fight this.
In the face of late-stage cancer, Chris and Keisha's vision of their shared future might have melted away, but it didn't. In August 2011, 8 months after Keisha's initial diagnosis, with her condition worsening, Chris proposed.
You can't guarantee what's tomorrow. You can't do that. It's one more day, I'll take it. Two, I'll take that. Yeah? But to have that with your wife, woman that you love, take me some seconds, if that's it. Give me 60 more seconds.
By the time of the wedding, Keisha was mostly confined to a wheelchair. But on that day, nothing could diminish her happiness.
Kind of see the strength. So it's not like you see just your wife coming, but really seeing everything about her that makes her, just in that moment, everything that makes her my wife.
Oh, so long for this night, I prayed that a star would guide you my way to share with me this special day. Well, ribbons in the sky for our love.
Within a few weeks of the wedding, Keisha's organs were failing, and her pain was increasing.
We were blessed to be able to have Christmas back here and have all the family came down, so she was able to talk to them. But, some battles you just don't win.
When Keisha died on December 27th, Chris was at her side. She was 38. They were married for only 5 weeks, far too briefly. But together, they had made every breath count.
It'll always be a great memory of seeing her walk down the aisle. That consistent fight. Just that each day that she's able to refocus. And to see that type of strength every day. Every day.
Chris and his foundation, Team Draft, have organized an undergraduate scholarship at Clemson University, where Keisha attended. To help raise lung cancer awareness, please log on to www.teamdraft.org. All proceeds go to lung cancer research and prevention. Ahead on Sunday, NFL Countdown in the shadow of the Super Bowl stadium that Peyton built. Hear what Manning has to say about his future in Indy. Jaws and John weigh in as well. And later, the Patriots' act of unselfishness that restored a sense of team to the game. Teddy Bruschi shares the tale of the greatest Super Bowl intro. And it's become a Super Bowl tradition here on Sunday Countdown. Adam Sandler stops by. His latest movie, That's My Boy. All ahead on Super Sunday edition of Countdown.
Hey, fellas, what's going on?
We're just doing a test to see what generates more force. Dwight here, or a professional rodeo bull.
Wouldn't want to be that tackling dummy.
SportsCenter, weekday mornings at 0700 CET, live on ESPN America.
With the first pick, the Indianapolis Colts select.
If you had the number one pick in the NFL draft, your pick would be who?
Robert Griffin III.
Quarterback draw, touchdown, Robert Griffin.
I think they've got to take Luck. I really do.
What we're saying with Andrew Luck, it's all about the guarantee.
This special day, we can do something that can be here forever.
It wasn't luck. He was meant to catch that ball.
The pageantry of Super Bowl 35 was larger than life.
Something else, huh? How cool is this?
The Baltimore Ravens took an early lead over the New York Giants with a Trent Dilfer touchdown pass to Brandon Stokely.
Throwing deep down the middle for Stokely. He's got it. 10-5. Touchdown. Yes! Brandon Stokely for the score.
Super Bowl MVP Ray Lewis led a Ravens defense that intercepted Giants quarterback Kerry Collins 4 times.
Slant over the middle. Picked up by Dwayne Stokes. He's got a touchdown. best defense in the business is showing the world why.
Yeah, baby!
With a 34-7 win, the Ravens captured their first Super Bowl victory in franchise history.
The Boston Bruins have won the Stanley Cup, and they pour on to celebrate with Tim Thomas, their heroic goaltender. And this will undoubtedly be the highest that it's ever been held.
Shoot!
Don't miss the NHL all season long, live on ESPN America.
Welcome back to this special Super Bowl edition of Sunday NFL Countdown, presented by IBM.
As you drive in and see Lucas Oil Stadium, almost every week it has been that image of Peyton Manning. That was on Monday as the Super Bowl bunting and pictures went up. He was replaced by his arch rival for much of this generation of great head-to-head in the AFC, Tom Brady. So it'll be another Manning brother trying to knock off Brady as opposed to Peyton Manning doing it. Look, along with the Rob Gronkowski ankle story, the other big story of this week has been the conversation of Peyton Manning. Anywhere you went, players, people within the league, the conversation was, what do you think is going to happen to Peyton? And very few people would give you an answer on the record, but most off the record would say, I don't think he's going to play for the Colts again. Time's going to tell how that plays out. In this week where his city is hosting the biggest game, Peyton Manning has kept a mostly low profile, but he did speak with our Trey Wingo earlier this week.
One question everyone wants to know is, how's your health?
Yeah, it's good. I really feel good. I've continued to make progress every day. Everything that the doctors have told me has been on point, which is encouraging to me. And that's what I'm going to continue to do. Just keep trying to get better. So far I have. That's the plan from here on out.
Have you thought at all about what your value would be if you hit the open market?
No, have not. Have not. I'm under contract with the Colts. I play for the Colts right now, and that's where I am right now.
How quickly, when this week ends, will you want to have these situations addressed?
Oh, I think the sooner the better. I really do. And so Jim and I are in constant communication, and after this week's over, we'll do it, and we'll make a good plan from there. Either way, it's going to be good. I'm at peace, and it'll be a positive thing, I can assure you.
Some of the comments of Peyton Manning this week. Let's bring in Adam Schefter and Chris Mortensen, who together reported midweek about a medical clearance level for Peyton here. So, guys, take us through the Jim Irsay, the Peyton Manning, the medical, and where we stand at this point with this story.
And one thing that the Dr. Robert Watkins, who did the fusion surgery on Peyton Manning in September, wanted to make clear is that this is no longer a safety issue. It's more about performance and where Peyton Manning is progressing as his nerves regenerate to his arm. And the one thing that Chris Winkie, who went through this surgery, told Peyton Manning that it was about at the six-month mark, which would be sometime in March, is when he started to really feel good about his throwing. At the nine-month mark, he felt like he was 100%. In fact, Winkie told Manning he was stronger, had a stronger arm once he went through the entire rehab process. So whether this is mid-March, whether this is before the draft April 25th, whether it's May 23rd, which is a year date from the original surgery he had, that's the timeline I think that he's hoping to get a spark.
And Mort, it shouldn't be too difficult to get a contract done. Peyton Manning is willing to do a contract with little or no money up front. In other words, he would play and have to earn every cent he makes. And you would structure that contract in a way, Mike, where he would be paid a big roster bonus at the start of the league year and more bonuses the way as the season goes along, Mike.
Yeah, as you guys have said, there's progress, but when will that progress be enough for somebody to say, okay, he's not going to be a Colt, he'll be one of our guys and be a quarterback? What's your read?
Well, if he's healthy and he's available, I'd be first in line to coach a sheriff. Now, it's going to take a staff that will accommodate Peyton Manning, meaning you want to tap every one of his resources, top of his head to the bottom of his feet. He's got to have input to achieve all the excellence that he's shown us over the years. Somebody's going to be very fortunate if he's available and he's healthy.
Yeah, I think we're going to hear the normal cast of characters, Washington, Miami, Seattle. I've got a little bit of a sleeper. The New York Jets. You know, there's a turf war going on in New York. The New York Giants are playing here today in the Super Bowl. The Jets want to be on the front cover of the New York papers. What a way to garner the headlines if you sign the great Peyton Manning.
This is the worst day for Jets fans. It's the team they share a stadium with who beat them in a big game, and the team, of course, in their division who they can't beat. Do you think we've seen the last of Peyton in this place as the Colts quarterback?
Yeah, I do. It's time to move on.
Yeah. What do you think?
I think so.
Yeah, it'll be interesting. It's something that everyone continues to talk about. You know, many of his contemporaries have been asked about it, too, and one of them comes to mind is our colleague Teddy Bruschi. Teddy Bruschi played against Peyton Manning, had an interception of Peyton Manning. But as we bring in Teddy, it is not about what you did. It is about what your team did with more wins over Manning and his Colts. And, Teddy, that in large part speaks to the Patriot way that we'll see on display again this Super Sunday.
That's right, Mike. It's always been about team in New England, and there have been many defining moments over this last decade of success for the Patriots. Vinatieri kicks, Brady's emergence, Belichick's game plans, but there was one moment that happened 10 years ago that truly started the Patriot way.
I always remembered the camera shot of the guy at right before his name is called, and it was a camera shot that they take upward. He's kind of looking into it. You can see his face through the helmet.
You dreamed about it, right? I can't wait to be introduced in the Super Bowl.
Was one moment that I was looking forward to. You know, Jerome Bettis running out there. Ah.
These are the private moments before the greatest game of your life. With hundreds of millions watching, and a championship on the line, you are about to step into history.
One that comes to mind is the Ray Lewis dance. I always wanted to have one like that when I come out to the Super Bowl and do stuff like that.
10 years ago, when I was with the New England Patriots, we changed all that.
It started back early in the season when we were playing the Cincinnati Bengals. We were getting all together to get called out individually.
Before we even got, to the field, they were already announcing our names and stuff like that, and we really felt disrespected.
Lawyer Malloy at the time, he was like, you know what? The hell with it.
Let's go out as a team.
Two days later, the Twin Towers fell in Manhattan.
The next game was right after 9/11. And, talk about unity. We all needed to be together, not just because of football, but because our whole country was hurting. We just wanted to let everybody know that we were true patriots.
Week after week, we came out as a team. And week after week, we won. We beat Oakland in the snow, the Steelers in Pittsburgh, and reached Super Bowl 36 against the Rams. In the week leading up to the game, there was an ongoing discussion between the Patriots and the NFL.
Bill came into the locker room, earlier than he usually do, so everybody was kind of looking around like, why is he in here? And he said, hey, I got something to tell you guys. Due to television, entertainment, they want us to come out individually. You could have heard a pin drop in there.
We said, we don't give a damn about the time. We're going to run out as a team. We made it here as a team. We're going to do this as a team.
Why change what you're doing? Why change, what really kind of got you there?
Everybody is just in a little commotion. And finally, I think I stood up and I said, hey, no, we want to go out as a team. Belichick said, okay, that's good enough for me.
They wanted to all do it together. I said, well, look, when the curtain's open, the whole team's going to run out there. You're going to do whatever you want to do.
The decision was made. We Patriots made our entrance together.
It just seemed, I don't even know how to explain it other than the fact that, the excitement level, it felt like you were going into battle, but you weren't scared.
The fact that we were so unified, coming out of that tunnel, I think that can be intimidating to any opponent, and I think it might have played itself out a little bit in that game.
Our decision to enter as a team was validated. We upset the heavily favored Rams. Since that day, all teams have been announced as a team at the Super Bowl.
That's the way to get introduced. I wish we would have thought of it first. That was awesome.
I'm glad that we're getting recognized for starting something so beautiful.
Without the guy standing next to you and the guy standing next to him, that without everyone doing their job, then no one's going to be successful.
It helped that we were red, white, and blue and our name was the Patriots, but I think it really was a special moment for the American public to see, because we're trying to rally together as a nation.
When I'm watching the Super Bowl, to see the Patriots go out as a team, quite honestly, is gonna be normal. I'm gonna expect that. That's what Patriots do.
In that Super Bowl against the Rams, plays still had to be made and the game had to be won still. But the one moment everyone remembers is when we came out as a team. Because what it did was reestablish what football was meant to be, a group of men coming together and playing as a team.
Well stated, Teddy, and obviously even better, well done. And it changed things really for the good in the backdrop of 9/11. I mean, nobody can ever forget what that meant, and the team named Patriots coming out just like that as a huge underdog, and they're going on to win, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So the question is, fellas, all right, look, you grow up as little kids, you're thinking the Super Bowl, but the introduction, you've been introduced to all. So Rob, you have a moment, not to turn what they did, but would it rob you of a moment?
I think for that, it depends on who you are, first of all, but I think for that particular team, that particular moment, it was great.
For that season.
For that season. But this is the National Football League. It is a copycat league. But I think if you watch that piece there, there was a lot of guys in there saying, hey, that moment, the Super Bowl, as a kid growing up, you look up, you watch it on television, and you say to yourself, if I ever make it there, my name will be called, I'll run out. I watched Steve Young run out, okay? I've seen Tom Jackson run out. But Bill Belichick and that team, for whatever reason, messed it up for everybody who wanted those dreams. That's the way I feel.
Yes.
Because now it's still going on, Tommy. Still going on.
I'm conflicted. I was introduced twice at the Super Bowl, and it was great because you do, you know, live that dream that you have as a kid. But would I sacrifice that in a second if you could reestablish what the Patriots got in that 0-1 season? Example, first Super Bowl I go to, Super Bowl 12. We're the Orange Crush. I know how we're going to play. I know what my group is getting ready to do. I didn't need to be introduced to do that. If introducing us as a team would have helped with the 8 turnovers on the other side of the ball, I'm all for it. Let them dudes run out first. I'm all for it.
Hey, look, to me, it is contextual. It is a great moment. I felt it. It was like, oh, I get to be introduced in the Super Bowl. This is going to be great. But in the big picture, football is the ultimate team game, and it was epitomized in that moment. If you want your name to be introduced every time you go out, go play golf. And the first tee, they clap, they say, Keyshawn Johnson from...
Steve, stop.
Play tennis. Here's the thing. I understand. It's overstatement. But here's the thing. Football was headed in the wrong direction. And we led by the NFL, by all of the stuff that was going on, the antics and everything else was taking away from what the core element of what the team, what football is. And so I look at that moment. I know that was 9/11 was a big piece of it, but it was also seminal for the game because what we do as NFL players, college guys do, high school kids do, little league kids do, they all copy it. And for me, I still tear up when I see it because everybody got the message.
Yes.
Football's back to its roots. I felt it at the moment that happened, and I felt it ever since I've seen that happen. I'm not saying you can't be introduced, that's fine. But the essence of what they did reestablished what I think football is. And what is core and what we love about the game. It's the ultimate human experience in sports.
Do you realize I watched you in a Super Bowl?
And I'm starting to tear up now.
Hold on. When I watched you in a Super Bowl dancing on the sideline when you had Deion, you and Jerry, you think I didn't watch that as a kid growing up?
I get it.
I mean, much respect to what they did. They captured the magic of the moment. But, guys, let's not trip. It's a team sport, but it's a bunch of individuals, and some of those guys are better than others. If you are a starter, you have earned the right to be introduced. If I'm the Miami Dolphins and I'm in this game with Dan Marino, Dan Marino needs to be introduced because the fans out there have come. Whichever whichever announcement gives the team the juice. If you are the Denver Broncos, the only reason why they're there is because the Orange Crush. They should be introduced. Keyshawn, you're on Tampa Bay. Defense, I got to tell you, homie, I got to see Warren Sapp in that defense. All right? Now, I'm the only
guy. And I can accept that.
Yeah, I'm the only guy without any Super Bowl experience, but I'm going to tell you, it'd be exciting to see somebody on the PGA Tour named Keyshawn teeing it off, though.
Now, here's the problem.
I'm afraid. Yeah.
Well, Sapp, that's why we bring in the lawyer from California, Connecticut, the senator from Utah. But one thing about the first tee, then it's an automatic shank.
When they announce their name. I mean, that's a whole other story.
It was beautiful, Teddy, what you did, and it reestablished a lot of things. Well, we do a lot of things on this show on the Super Bowl Sunday NFL Countdown. We've got folks, and I think he's made this show more than I have.
You're right.
Adam Sandler. Big movie buff, big football buff. Look at him.
What's up, guys? How are you?
How are you?
What's up, guys?
You like that?
Good luck today. Hey, if it's going to help.
I know what my dude is going to do, but if it's going to
help. Countdown. Presented by IBM. Brought to you by Allstate. The only car insurance with a claim satisfaction guarantee.
Welcome to Sports Nation.
That's it. One person says yay. Would you guys like some?